come to your country and attend this function. For me, this is a long cherished dream that comes true. I've all along regarded myself as one of the luckiest person among my generation. People born in China in the early 1950s, basically for two reasons. First, just a few years before China adopted opening up policy, I was enrolled in Beijing Foreign Languages Institute in 1973, majoring in English language and literature. In the early 1970s, China's universities and colleges were not fully recovered from the turmoil of the so-called Cultural Revolution. And every year, no more than 150,000 young people would be enrolled in the institutions of higher learning. Now it is around 7 million. And the second reason is that, as the name of my organization would inform you, international understanding has been my life career. In December 1978, a very important meeting in the third plenary session of the 11th Central Committee of the Communist Party of China was held, and the attention of the CPC, the Chinese government, and the whole nation was gradually shifted to something more practical, economic development and improvement of people's living standard. By that time, talented people of any kind were badly in need everywhere. In the year of 1977, I was assigned a job in the International Department of CPC Central Committee. And in 1979, I was sent to study in Canada in a college named Lester B. Pearson College of the Pacific. It was a very small college, but very international in nature. There were only 20 students, but they came from more than 50 countries. The motto of the college was international understanding. And when I returned to China in 1981, it so happened that the CPC and other political parties, mass organizations, and important mass personages of all walks of life jointly initiated the Chinese Association for International Understanding, CAFIU for short. And from then on, international understanding had become my life career. And for me, English language was mainly a tool to promote international understanding. I worked in IDCPC for more than three decades now. First as an interpreter, then a desk officer for Zimbabwe and Somalia. Later, a director of the section that in charge of Anglophone Africa. Deputy Director General and Director General of the African Bureau, not missing any layer in the entire hierarchy. After reform and opening up, CPC's international relations was no longer part of the so-called international communist movement, but that of the country's comprehensive diplomacy. Party-to-party relations were not based on similar ideologies, but four principles of independence, equality, mutual respect, and non-interference into each other's internal affairs. So basically what we were doing was to promote international understanding, informing each other the latest development in the country and the region, sharing ideas on the world situation and exploring possibilities of bilateral cooperation in various sectors. These efforts have actually also served our own need to understand China's national conditions and its relation with the outside world. The prerequisite to promote international understanding is that you yourself should have at least a rudimentary understanding of your own country, your interlocutor's country, and the world in general. During the 1980s and 90s, we were also engaged in international academic exchange and comparative studies with Africanists from the United States, the United Kingdom, France, and USSR. One point to prove that I had been a lucky person was that my effort to understand Africa led to a combination of serving as a Chinese ambassador to Ethiopia between March 2001 and August 2004. When I returned home, my responsibility was changed to neighboring countries in the South and Southeast Asia. To sum up, my life career of international understanding has taken me to more than 90 countries. Now, what can I say about international understanding? I believe that first of all, we must have a strong interest and desire to learn about other peoples and their countries. In this globalizing world, there are plenty of opportunities for cooperation. Secondly, we must respect other people and treat them as equals, particularly those from the least developed countries. It is not their fault to be poor and underdeveloped. To the contrary, they will have a good chance to catch up so long as they avail themselves of the comparative advantages of the latecomers. Thirdly, one must try his or her best to accumulate the necessary knowledge about the target areas such as history, tradition, culture, etc. And a shortcut is to cooperate with other people that share the same interest in area studies. Of course, realizing international understanding will not be a smooth sailing all the time. There could be many obstacles and difficulties. Old people tend to understand other people and countries according to their own experience, their own national interests, their own terms, concepts, categories, theories, and discourses, and their established ideas, consensus, and mainstreams, interest groups to support particular ideas. My personal experience is to follow traditional Chinese theory of knowledge, to integrate seeking knowledge with practice. The way to judge different theories is to see which could best explain the present and predict the future. In helping others to understand China, I believe it is also necessary to have a sympathetic and considerate mind, trying to provide as much information as possible of the latest development, offer them various theories, let them judge which would help them understand the present situation the best. The most important thing is to help them understand the fundamentals of our national conditions. Where did we come from and where to go? What made us to choose the present possible development, the strategy, and the related policies? It's in the sense of integration of knowledge seeking with the practice of meeting people of targeted countries that I say I was very lucky to be Chinese ambassador to Ethiopia. For that, I was not just writing about African development, but trying it together with my Ethiopian friends through Sino-Ethiopian cooperation in various fields. But before this trip, my life career had not brought me to the most important brainstorming yet. When I retired from the frontline job in IDCPC in 2014 and became a vice president of CAFIU, I realized that all along I had taken the English language as a tool to understand other people and help other people to understand China. Yet so far I had missed the most important group, those native speakers of English, people of Anglosphere in general, those from UK in particular. So I decided that I should make a trip to the UK, Ireland, and Iceland. For your objective and a correct understanding of rejuvenating China is important worldwide. Now I'd like to inform you about the latest development in China. I had started this trip almost directly from Beijing's Great Wall of People, where the fourth annual session of China's 12th National People's Congress and the Chinese People's Political Consultative Conference were held between March the 3rd and the 16th. On March the 5th, together with 2,890 NPC deputies and about 2,100 CPCC members, I listened to Premier Li Keqiang's report on the work of the government. During the 2 hours, there seemed more applause than usual. My personal count was 44. For greater need for encouragement, the achievements of 2015 did not come easily, though the growth rate of 6.9% was the lowest in 25 years. The reasons? Internationally, the environment was, to say the least, complicated and challenging. The world economic growth fell to the lowest in 6 years, and the total volume of trade shrank, and the commodity prices plummeted. Domestically, these irritated problems became more prominent, and downward pressure was mounting, and there was so-called new normal. Well, while dealing with the slowdown in economic growth, making difficult structural adjustments, and absorbing the effects of previous economic stimulus policies, China was also confronting them with many difficult problems and choices, and this called for effective responses based on the need both to combine long-term and short-term considerations and to seek benefits and avoid harm. During the year 2015, the Chinese government made strenuous efforts to maintain stable growth, made structural adjustments, guarded against the risks, and developed new ways of conducting micro-regulations. It had also intensified reform and opening up to invigorate the market and promote industrial innovation and upgrading to improve economic performance, as well as more coordinated development between regions and new types of urbanization to expand the development space. Another aspect was to promote reform and development in social endeavors to improve people's living standards. The last but not least, the government developed new ways of conducting law-based administration and governance to promote social harmony and stability. The result was that the economy operated within an appropriate range, and the GDP reached 67.67 trillion yuan, representing an increase of 6.9% over the previous year. The employment situation remained stable, with 13.12 million new urban jobs created. The service sector, as a proportion of the GDP, rose to 50.5%, accounting for more than half for the first time. The contribution of consumption to economic growth reached 66.4%. High-tech industries and equipment manufacturing grew faster than other industries, and energy consumption per unit of GDP fell by 5.6%. New driving forces for development grew rapidly, and living standards improved. Personal per capita disposable income increased by 7.4% in real terms, overtaking the growth rate of the economy. By the end of last year, personal saving deposits had risen by 8.5%, an increase of more than 4 trillion yuan. The Premier told the audience that a comprehensive analysis of all factors showed that China would face more and tougher problems and challenges this year and had to be ready to fight a difficult battle. He proposed to carry out the following tasks: improve and keep stable the macroeconomic policies to ensure that the economy performs within appropriate range, strengthen supply-side structural reform to drive sustained growth, tap the potential of domestic demand and increase the space for development, speed up efforts to develop modern agriculture and ensure sustained increase in rural incomes, step up environmental governance efforts and work to see breakthrough in green development, strengthen social development to promote people's well-being and improve government functions, strengthen the administrative capacity, and deliver quality government services. When we were deliberating the report, I was anticipating this trip to the UK, Ireland, and Iceland, and could not refrain from comparing the political systems of these countries and that of China. I learned when I was in school that the UK was supposed to be the first or second borough democracy in the world. The king wanted to fight a war, and there was the need to fund it. But the parliamentarians emphasized that no representation, no tax. And then there was the Civil War and the Glorious Revolution and the steady expansion of the right to vote. In contemporary China, the CPC, after a successful new democratic revolution, won the hearts of the people and established a people's republic. And after a period of transition, a socialist transformation, a terrible decade of the so-called Cultural Revolution, and more than three decades of reform and opening up that had led to integrated development in economic, political, social, cultural and ecological sectors. Now the core of China's political system is a combination of the party's leadership, the people's status as master of the country through the People's Congress's system and the rule of law. The strategies and policies are initiated by CPC through proposal and then are expanded into plan by the relevant organs of the State Council and put before the NPC deputies for consideration and approval and before CPPCC National Committee members for suggestions and advice. This process of decision making may last for years if the relevant investigation and rounds of consultation are included. Is this an authoritarian capitalism? Are there no democratic elements involved? Democracy means governance of the people, by the people, and for the people, and then goes far beyond the selection of the leaders every few years. And also include democratic decision making, administration, and supervision. The two sessions every year is a highlight that attracts worldwide attention. And coming here from that event, I will not pretend to understand everything discussed there, but I'm willing to share with you the knowledge I obtained through participation of a democratic system with Chinese characteristics. I thank you for your attention.